Hi, my name is Kate Crowley from Teachers College, Columbia University, here in New York City. Welcome to Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding video tutorials. This is module 3, where we're going to look at oral exam, speech assessment, and speech therapy strategies for cleft palate. Module 3.1, we look specifically at how to do an oral exam and at speech assessment.
It's important to do an oral exam to check the oral structure and function of the oral cavity. First, you should look at for any fistulas, including alveolar fistulas. So in this child, you see a little small fistula in the palate. It's not a cleft palate, it's just a fistula. So the cleft was repaired and then the seams opened and resulting in this fistula. Next, you see a bigger fistula. Now this, again, is not a cleft palate. The cleft palate was repaired, and after the repair, the seams ripped, leaving this fistula. Here is another fistula. And then you'll see a little fistula that is in the alveolar ridge of the cleft palate. Here's a small fistula. Again, it's very important to detect that because there'll be sounds and air coming out of that hole. So look closely because some are smaller than others. And then this one, the alveolar fistula, might be a hard one to detect since most people may just look at the palate. But remember that fistulas can also occur in the alveolar ridge. So you may lift the child's lip to see if there's any holes in those areas. When doing an oral exam, you also want to check to see the amount of space between the velum and the posterior pharyngeal wall. As you may recall from the previous module, the velum needs to move up and back against the posterior pharyngeal wall. So if there's a lot of space, it'll be hard to achieve that velar pharyngeal closure. When looking at the child's mouth, you'd like to look at the soft palate. So have the child say, ah, and observe to see how that soft palate is moving and if it should be moving. Also, you may look at the lateral pharyngeal walls, and at times you may also see those lateral pharyngeal walls moving medially. Lastly, you'll have the patient say, ka, 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 and you'll look to see at the soft palate to see if there's an inverted V. An inverted V is a sign of a submucous cleft. It's important to look at the functioning of cranial nerves to see if there's any damage. Some of the syndromes associated with cleft palate may involve damage to the cranial nerves. So when looking at an oral exam, when doing an oral exam, you'll want to look at the lips. They should have good retraction, so have them smile. Also, they should have good protrusion, so have them round their lips. Then you'll look at their tongue. Can they move their tongue from side to side? Can their tongue touch the alveolar ridge? They should be able to do all these things in order to produce certain sounds. Also, when having them make these movements, check to see if there's symmetry. So when they retract their lips, does one side droop or is one side tighter than the other? Or when they move their tongue from side to side, can they move it towards one side more than the other? That may be indicators of paralysis, and that would affect production of certain sounds. Also, you want to look to see if there's oral apraxia. So do they have difficulty coordinating movements? So when you have them retract and protrude, is that more difficult for them? Do you see any signs of groping? So sort of like this. So have them retract, protrude, retract, and protrude. Is it hard for them? Also, oral apraxia might be seen when they coordinate sound movements. So when you have them say pa ta ka, are they able to move from a bilabial pa to an alveolar ta to a ka, an alveolar? Or do they get stuck and start making different errors such as pa ka la ta la pa 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 ta ka? Next, you also want to check the bottom of their tongue. Do they have ankyloglossia? So that's the frenulum. That's that tissue that's right on the bottom of your tongue that attaches your tongue to your mouth. Is it very short? If it's very short, it'd be very hard for them to move their tongue up. You need that tongue to move up for the L, the F sound. So if it's a short frenulum, it'll affect those sounds. Also, it may affect feeding. It may be hard for them to move their tongue in order to express milk from a nipple. Lastly, you'll like to see their maxilla and their mandible. So is their maxilla protruding forward, making it hard to produce an S? Or is the mandible protruding forward, making it hard to make an F sound? When looking at their child's mouth, you'll also want to look for indicators of a submucous cleft. So check to see if there's a bifid or small uvula. So that would be a uvula that's split in half or it's just tiny. Also, you want to look in the mouth to see if there's a bluish tone to it. So if you shine a light to the roof of their mouth and you see a bluish tone, that might be the zona pellucida, which is also an indicator of submucous cleft. Also, with your pinky, if you touch the roof of their mouth and you feel a notch, that notch between the hard and soft palate may also be an indicator of a submucous cleft. So when looking at a child's mouth, you'll look at their lips, you'll look at their tongue, you'll look at their palate, you'll look at their velum, and also you'll look at their teeth. You want to make sure that the teeth are erupting normally. So are there any teeth that are missing? Are there any teeth that are rotated or not aligned properly? You'll also check for any dental decay. So do you see brownish stuff on their teeth? Looking at their maxilla to see if it's protruding. So is it a class 2 malocclusion? So that would be an overbite. Or is it a retrusive maxilla? So that's a class 3 malocclusion, so an underbite.
When assessing a child's speech, we also want to check for resonance. And resonance is how much air is resonating within their oral cavity. Some people sound hypernasal. Some people sound hyponasal, and some people have a cul-de-sac resonance, which is potato in the mouth.
It can sound like this.
A way to distinguish hypernasality from hyponasality is the Kummer test. So to test hyponasality, have the child repeat the sentence, "My mommy makes milk." And if they are hyponasal, it'll sound like, "My mommy makes milk." A way to test for hypernasality, you can have the child repeat the sentence, "Buy Bobby a bike." And if it's hypernasal, it'll sound like, "My mammy, oh my."
Puppy will pull a rope.
Puppy will pull a rope.
Another way to assess for hypernasality is to have the child produce the E vowel and plug their nose. So a way to do this is have them say E, and if their resonance is typical, the E vowel should not change. However, if they are hypernasal and a lot of air is resonating in the nasal cavity, the E vowel may shift a little, such as E. So again, you're assessing for resonance. However, therapy does not necessarily target resonance. It's more of a structural issue. So if the child does have significant hypernasality, this will need to be fixed with the surgery. Another thing that's important to note is that resonance can be a cultural component as well. So in some cultures in Ghana, they have a very big resonance to their voice. Whereas other cultures, we see women up in the Andes Mountains in Bolivia with a very high pitch and hypernasal resonance. So just be aware of the culture that you're working with.
So now we're ready to begin the assessment piece of the high pressure sounds. We've looked at the palate, we've looked at the oral mechanism, we've thought about resonance, and now we're going to think about the sounds themselves, the speech sounds themselves. So we're going to assess all of the speech sounds in a language. In this particular video, we're using English, but there's many other sounds in other languages that we have to think about, which we'll talk about in the next module. But right now, we'll think about the sounds in English. So the high pressure sounds are the ones that are going to be likely affected by cleft palate because there can't be velopharyngeal closure because there's a hole there. We're going to think about which of the affected ones are stimulable using the cleft palate speech therapy strategies, which we're going to present in the next module. So here's the assessment piece. We start with the single sounds, then we move to words, then we move to sentences. We might even use more conversational speech to assess it, but we start with the single sounds. We will use the AmeriCleft sentences developed by Dr. Judith Trost Cardaman and her colleagues. And here in the assessment piece, we're looking for how correct is the placement of the articulators and how the sounds are produced, such as through compensatory errors or nasal emissions or something else. I actually like to warm things up, to have the patients count to 10. I like to hear what's going on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I hear a lot of different sounds in there, especially the high pressure sounds, and they go pretty quickly together. I also sometimes, if they're a little bit older, I have them count from 60 to 70, and then we get all the high pressure sounds, the high pressure fricatives like the S sounds. The Americleft sentences are a beautiful set of sentences that were created that get rid of virtually all the sounds that are high pressure except for the ones we're looking at, or in the case of nasals, all of the sounds except for that particular nasal sound, plus the low pressure sounds and the vowels. Let me give you an example. For example, for the mm nasal sound, the single sound would be mm, the word might be mom, and then the sentence you might have the child repeat is, Mom and Amy are home. Remember, that's an N, because you don't want to have the D there, which is one of the high pressure sounds. So, Mom and Amy are home. N, no. Anna knew no one. As you can see, it's the N, and every other sound is a vowel or a low pressure sound. N, hanging. We are hanging on. Now we're going to look at those low pressure sounds. Again, kids with cleft palate should be able, patients with cleft palate should be able to make these sounds. So the Harry, hurry ahead, Harry. Ul, lily, Laura will wear a lily. Wa, we were away, and Ray will arrive early. Now we get into the high pressure sounds of English. So the first one I generally start with is the p, puppy. Puppy will pull a rope, and I'm listening to whether that p can be produced. Is the placement right? Is there an explosion of air behind it? How does it work in a single word, puppy? And then let's hear the sentence, puppy will pull a rope. B, b, of course it's the b, baby. Buy baby a bib. Listening for those sounds, I'm looking for placement. Is there an explosion of air? Is it a high pressure sound? Is it more like a mamie? Is it a good b baby? T, turtle, your turtle ate a hat. D, dad, do it today for dad. G, give Aggie a hug. Sissy saw Sally race. Now I listen for the first, the sound on its own, s, have the child repeat it. If they do that, okay, then I'd go to the sissy. Then I go, sissy saw Sally race. Again, I'm looking for placement, I'm looking for manner. Is it continuant? Is there turbulence? Are things coming out the nose when they should all be coming out the mouth? And that's what I'm doing for each one. Here's another high pressure sound, zzz. Zoe. Zoe has roses. Three. 32 teeth. Other. The other feather. Shh. Dish. She washed a dish. Chew. The single sound is ch. Chew. Watch a choo-choo. J. George. George saw Gigi. Fly. A fly fell off a leaf. V. View. I love every view. So by the end of this list, I will have heard virtually all the high pressure sounds in English, and I will have known how that child produces them in terms of placement. Is p here, is d there. I will know whether there's an explosion of air, or is the p more like a m, or is the d more like a n, and then I'll see perhaps they can make the p, but maybe they need work on the single words, or maybe it falls apart in the sentences. And by the end of this list, I'll have a lot of good information about how that child can produce the sounds. So once we've done that analysis, now we're going to see which sounds are stimulable using cleft palate speech therapy strategies. So that's what we're going to look at in the next module, to learn the cleft palate speech therapy strategies. Then you can bring them back into your assessment process to see, okay, here are the sounds that have broken down. Now, can I stimulate any of those sounds? Which ones are the most stimulable that I might then choose for my treatment plan. Remember that if a child can make one of those high pressure sounds that we looked at, it is likely that child only needs speech therapy and no other surgery. But of course, if the child has an open cleft, that child will not be able to make those high pressure sounds. But if that child does, remember that it's a speech therapy job, not a surgical job. This concludes Module 3.1. We're now going to move into Module 3.2, which looks at cleft palate speech therapy strategies.